This is Theater Talk. I'm Susan Haskins. One of the most beloved musical classics has made it to the screen as a spectacular new movie. We're very pleased to have its director with us and the mega composer who wrote this hit. Here to introduce them, my co-host, Michael Riedel of the New York Post.
Yes, we've got the mega composer and the director, but he's a mega director too. The Phantom of the Opera is one of my favorite musicals. It has been given a beautiful, sumptuous, gorgeous movie version now out in theaters, directed by Joel Schumacher, who is our first-time guest here in Theater Talk.
Thank you for having me. Welcome to Theater Talk. It's good to see you.
And a man I've admired, grown up with listening to his wonderful shows and scores, Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Thank you.
The first time on Theater Talk, too.
Yes, indeed.
So good to see you. All right. Phantom of the Opera, it's been quite a while in the making going to the big screen. What, Andrew, were the particular obstacles and challenges to getting it there?
Well, we met Joel and I in 1988, mm-hmm. and I very much wanted Joel to be the director there because I'd seen The Lost Boys, which I thought had a fantastic use of music and the visuals and the whole thing combined with a sort of rock and roll sensibility too, which I really liked. We were going to go with the movie very, very quickly, mm-hmm. As you would know, I mean, at that time it was rolling out in the theatre and all my theatre collaborators were getting very nervous about the idea, and say the production in Germany and the production in Japan said they wouldn't go if we had a movie, and so we decided in the end to put it on ice.
Mm-hmm. About 1990. Yeah.
Well,
we had prepared it, and then we
talked about it a lot, and a very great deal of what we talked about has made it into the version that we've just made.
What were the first things that you talked about when you in 1990 when you started to look at this musical?
How did you see it? 1988. We started in 90. I've got to put myself back there. Well, you know, it was always important when you're dealing with a famous novel or anything that has a life of its own. You want to keep the essence of it so that what's made it great still exists. But then you have to totally rethink it because, of course, it's a cinematic experience, and then you want to feel that you can create the same kind of excitement for a movie audience with a different language.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And how influential, though, was Hal Prince's production? Because that's a beautiful production on that stage, one of the great productions of all time. Did you want to get away from what Hal did and really radically rethink it?
I think because we were thinking of this entirely as a movie, mm-hmm. We didn't really consider what was on stage, although we know, I mean, everybody would say that the designs, particularly of Maria Bjornsson, were quite sensational in the mm-hmm. theatre. Mm-hmm. But we really did approach it as if it was a completely new new venture, mm-hmm. A completely new staging of it. And I think if we hadn't done that, I think all we'd have done would have been to have sort of filmed a stage show. That I really hope we haven't done.
No, we haven't, yeah.
I'm surprised, though, actually, how, I know it's been reinvented for the movies, but it tracks fairly closely, if I remember, to the show itself, with some key changes. I mean, the chandelier in the show comes down
at the end of the first act.
At the end of the first act, yep. And now you've saved this till the end.
Well, that was Andrew's idea, and I thought that was our biggest and greatest structural change because I wanted to burn the theater down. Yep. And of course, if I had done that in the middle of the movie, then I'd have to rebuild it for the next act. So that was really great. I think that if you look at the Lon Chaney silent film,
which I did last week, in fact,
which was the first rendition of Phantom that was done. After the book success, mm-hmm. which was done as the movie for Lon Chaney, you'll see that even Hal's wonderful production with Andrew is borrowed from that.
Yeah.
And it all comes from the book. And it's all what I think Andrew and Hal's version did that is so brilliant, and then I took it and put that on steroids, mm-hmm. was that up until the musical, the Phantom and Christine's relationship has always been monster and damsel in distress, you know, the famous, which you always see in all the old movies. And actually, what the musical does, and we've enhanced it, I think, is it's really a very young love story. And
it's a love triangle.
Yes, and we beefed up Raoul's part, you know, the lover, so that it really is a true triangle, and that Christine always greets the Phantom, not with horror, but with compassion.
And you went with this sexy actor to be the Phantom.
Well, why not?
I mean, if you saw the original Music of the Night with Michael and Sarah,
mm-hmm. it was quite sexy.
Very sexy. I remember, I mean, Sarah was a trained dancer, and I remember when they rehearsed that, and I mean, that was, It was
Michael was a matinee idol when he opened the Phantom here in New York.
Yes, he was.
Yes. Having been a sitcom star in
England. Yes, but Michael was not a romantic lead actor. He had a character flair that was quite special.
When he put the mask on and the wig and the costume and when he grabbed Sarah and when he sang Music of the Night, he was a very attractive male figure on the stage.
Absolutely.
I mean, he was not a creature of horror, ever.
No.
Well, let's put it this way. I mean, when you go to the Phantom of the Opera on stage, and indeed in the movie, women fall for the Phantom. Yeah. They don't fall for
Always.
Raoul.
Well, that's our great joke. What we used to say in the old days was, you know, there's Sarah for 2.5, 3 hours on stage, you know, working her butt off, right? She would get lovely applause. Michael would be on for what, 17 minutes altogether?
He's got two songs.
17 minutes, and he gets a standing ovation. I think there's a reason for that. I don't think it's just that people fall for the Phantom. I think people relate to the Phantom. I don't think you relate to the object of desire in stories. I think you relate to the person who's rejected and who is filled with longing and desire.
Interesting point, though, about the movie, because I think this is sort of your brilliance in reconceiving the Phantom when you did it as a musical is you decided not to go with the figure of horror, but to create this very sensitive. Was this your idea, and how did this come about?
Yes, you see, originally, going right back into the early 80s, when I first knew Sarah, just after she did Cats, of course, in London, but she was offered the lead in a production of the Phantom of the Opera, which was to use real opera, and was to be one of those sort of, it was to go to Joan Littlewood's theatre or Stratford East, and it was a sort of very camp romp. It was kind of
Rocky Horror Show.
Yes, because in fact, Cameron McIntosh and I went to go and see it, and we thought maybe it could be developed in some way for something for Sarah, and she didn't want to do it, by the way. But we thought it might be an idea for Jim Sharman, because I knew Jim Sharman because he did Jesus Christ Superstar in London, and Jim said he'd moved way on from there, and I mean, it tells you what it's like, because I mean, as he did the Rocky Horror, it showed you what sort of thing it was. And nothing ever happened with it, and that was the end of that. About 18 months later, I was here in New York, and I was going through one of those book fairs in Fifth Avenue on a Sunday, and I saw a copy of the Gaston Leroux book there for sort of a couple of dollars or something, and I thought I'd buy it, because I hadn't got anything to do in that afternoon, and funnily enough, it was the night of the pre-Tony party for the nominees. And
had you been nominated then?
Yeah, I had been nominated for something I knew perfectly well. There was no chance of my ever winning at all.
And what was that?
I can't remember. I think it was Song and Dance, I think it might have been. Anyway, I've been nominated for that, and I thought I'd read this in the afternoon, and I read the book, and couldn't believe how confused it was. I mean, it was a detective story at one moment, it was a horror story at one moment, it was a sort of, let me tell you, gentle reader, history lesson at one moment. But what I was unprepared for, it was also a high romance with a bit of Svengali in it, of course. Yeah. And it ends with the line that when the Phantom is for some reason exhumed, I don't know why, that he finds Christine's ring, that they find Christine's ring on his finger. And I thought, ouch, now this is the beginning of something. Mm. And then luck plays so much. I mean, if I hadn't passed that bookshop, I would never have thought of it. That evening, I met Hal Prince, who'd also been nominated for something that he had no chance in winning whatsoever.
What was that? Grind, maybe?
I think he could have been.
Hal's lean period before you came along and saved
it. It could have just been Grind. And you said it first. I said, Hal. Hal said, let's get out of here and let's have a drink. And it was also in the night where the Plaza Hotel was on strike, where this thing was. So we had to come up with this gauntlet of people throwing things at us. And so Hal and I found somewhere. And I said, I found this book, The Phantom of the Opera. I want to do a high romance. And Hal said, so do I. And I said, but Hal, you know, Evita is not high romance. I mean, your stuff with Steve Sondheim is not high romance. You sure about this? He said, yeah, kid. He said, he always called me kid. He said, if you finish this thing, call me. And all out of that one evening.
The most successful show of all time. I think you really put your finger on something, though, that's in the musical, but made very clear in the movie. You do identify with the Phantom because we all know what it's like to be in love with someone who doesn't love us and to be rejected. And would you say that the Phantom's anger and his expression of that rejection is pulling the damn chandelier on everybody because you're so annoyed by not being loved?
Yes. I think it's even more complicated in ours because the truth is the way Emmy Rossum, who plays Christine, plays it and the way we chose to do it is I think that before Patrick Wilson's character came along, I think that she has the capacity, as a human being to look past what he considers unlovable. Mm-hmm. Patrick's arrival, and because it's her childhood sweetheart, triggers something in him, which is a, you know, obviously crouching only to spring, a madness in him,
jealousy.
Created from his loneliness, but not an ordinary jealousy, you know, a destructive and then ultimately violent and murderous rage. And I think that leads to all the destruction that happens after that, which then makes it impossible for her to really be with him.
Right.
Because he's actually become somebody who's quite mad. But the tragedy of it is, I think, another time, another place, they could have been lovers. And of course, a lot of people, when they see the film, want her to stay with him.
It's the same way when you see the musical.
I know.
You can feel the women rooting for her to stay with the Phantom.
I know. I know.
Now,
because people do suffer, and people do suffer with longing, and having worked with some of the most famous objects of desire in the whole world, they don't think of themselves that way. No one thinks of themselves as the one that everyone wants.
Right.
People suffer with whatever their own problems are, and their own rejections, and their own, you know, their own suffering.
Now, I was thinking about your movie, having seen the Lon Chaney film last week, and they built all of these great sets for the Lon Chaney film.
They brought over a man from the Paris Opera, who was one of the art directors, and he built them.
Built them on the Warner Brothers lot. You guys?
No, Universal.
Universal, right?
The theater is still there.
Oh, really? That
the
they built
that. Bit of it is, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Oh, you've seen it.
They use it on the tour. Yeah.
Oh, interesting. You guys created Paris and the Paris Opera House at what studio in England?
Pinewood.
It's actually not the Paris Opera. It's sort of our own. It's called the Opera Populaire.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that because it reminds me of the Paris Opera, though. I mean, in some ways, you borrow from
only the illusion of it, because the actual Paris Opera, first of all, the scale is huge.
Yeah.
And on film, you'd have to get so far back to shoot it. It's also quite architectural and beautiful, but quite cold and almost municipal. And we decided, because you're in the theater for so much of the film, I said to Anthony Pratt, why don't we make it a personality, a beautiful woman, and there, hence all the use of the beautiful
mood. I was going to say, the theater becomes a character in the movie.
Well, it is. It's the Phantom of the Opera, so that's the co-star.
Right.
And you see, the thing about the chandelier in our version, as he drops it, he's destroying his whole world in one fell swoop.
He's just destroying what he loves.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So it's a huge difference to what we do in the theater in that sense.
Yes, and it's such an ugly act of desperation because so many innocent people would be harmed, too. Yeah.
Now, I think the music is scored really, really beautifully in this movie. How many musicians did you have here?
Well, we had over 100 pieces sometimes. 110, I think, was the most we got to.
At Abbey Road, which was really exciting.
But I mean,
there were so many musicians that and the recording studios there are tiny. They were against the walls with their instruments. It was really fantastic.
Can you ever go back to the theater, though, Andrew? I mean, you know, 25 puny and with the unions and the negotiations, they keep cutting the musicians down in the orchestra. You've had 125 now?
Well, you can't really cut the Phantom down much more than it is when we'd opened. No, I mean, it's fantastic luxury to have, Abbey Road, and which is, I think, one of the great recording studios of the world, you know. But also, I mean, we had another luxury, which was marvelous, is that because some of my music team had been drafted in at the very end onto Evita, because they needed a bit of help, they worked out what on film was needed to be able to allow actors to give a performance which could be recorded. Mm. See, up until now, really, with musicals, everything has been pre-recorded, in one sense, the performance is, well, in every sense, the performance is preordained.
And you're trapped with the performance you did in a recording studio months
with
ago.
This,
so you got to direct around a recording in some way.
Well, we didn't, though.
This is remarkable.
Very much of what you hear on that is recorded from the set itself and then repaired afterwards, but even more significantly, because it was being recorded as we went along, Simon Lee, our musical director, was always at the set, and then when he came to put the orchestra was put on to the speed that the singers and the actors had created it.
Yeah, so if they cry or pause or whisper or speak a word in the middle of a song or do anything, it's all there. Also, what Andrew pointed out to me is because Emmy Rossum, who plays Christine, was 16 when we started and then turned 17 while we were making the film, Andrew said to me in the middle of it, her voice is maturing even as we work. So he was able to record her at the end with a much more mature voice. And if you actually, you know, in the film...
But that works, though. She's maturing as a performer.
Yes, exactly. It's brilliant. And she's a girl in the beginning when you first see her. And she's really a formidable young woman by the end of the piece. Well, she's been through a lot.
That's true. Now, give us a sense. I know, having written about Andrew for years in the theater, I get a sense from theater people about what he's like to work for. I mean, he is the boss of an Andrew Lloyd Webber show, and he's in charge of everything. What is it like for you, who's generally the boss of a Joel Schumacher movie, to work with this this man?
Well, you know, we, because Andrew plucked me out of the chorus, I mean, talk about luck that he saw this little teenage vampire movie I did at very early in my career and then said to Sarah Brightman, this is our director. I mean, I don't know how he even stumbled into the theater to see this movie, but although we didn't make the film in 1990, we did become very close friends by that time. Mm-hmm. And with Andrew's wife, Madeline, who we met around that time. And so we had this 16-year friendship before we decided to do it again. So we had lots of shorthand and also had a relationship that had been tested, including canceling a movie when we had worked hard on it, you know, which some relationships don't.
And we
always saw each other if we were in each other's cities. So as you know, when you go into that, that's the good news and the bad news, because the bad news was I wouldn't want to fail him after all this time. So that's an added pressure. But fools rush in. But I think I have to say this on Andrew's behalf, he doesn't pretend to know about film. So actually, the visual part of the film, the actors, the storytelling, really that was left to me. Of course, I would show Andrew everything, and he was very supportive. And he did this brilliant job of reorchestrating the music, and also, more importantly, I think, encouraged these young people who were very nervous about working with him every day. I never saw him criticize them, and I never saw him put them down. He always came to the set and told them how great they were doing, and they needed that where the music was concerned.
Well, I can see. I mean, you would be intimidating to sing for.
I mean, well, I don't know. I don't think I am. But
he's actually really shy.
You're the most successful composer in the history of the world.
He's really shy.
I find it much more difficult. You know, when people come and they sing an audition, this, that, and the other, then it makes me get an awful frisson because you just so will everybody to work. You know?
Yeah.
Particularly when Jerry came to sing
Jerry
for
Butler,
me.
You know Patrick.
Who's your phantom?
Patrick and Emmy were trained singers.
Right. Patrick was a shoo-in, you know.
Yeah, Patrick was, and Jerry Butler, you know, had sung in a rock band in Edinburgh, you know. So
allegedly.
Yes, I think he shook the tambourine and picked up girls. Is what I really think happened.
But he came in, you know, and I could see exactly what Joel meant. I mean, you've got this incredible presence, and I could see he had this amazing connection with the idea and the part that
the
he
passion of
had.
The
he
character
about
where
it.
He owned it.
I mean, with such passion, it was extraordinary. I mean, I was sort of praying when he opened his mouth, and he absolutely had a wonderful rock tenor voice. You know, it was there, very, very raw, but there.
And you loved the counterpoint to Patrick's voice.
Yes, so I thought, well, you've got the sort of Irish lyric tenor on the one hand, if you like, and then you've got this voice on the other, which is much more dangerous. So the main thing there was, and this is always the case, it's not me, as I'm not a musical director, or conductor, or a voice trainer. It's not me who's going to have to bring the artist through. It's whoever is doing exactly that. And in this case, it was Simon Lee, who's, I think, one of the most talented musical directors I've ever worked with. Mm-hmm. And I said to Simon, I defer to you. I think he's terrific. I bet you're the one who's going to have to bring him through. Simon took him away and worked with him and came back and said, I can deliver this.
Yeah. Well, certainly, you do detect the rock quality to his voice, but it's also a mellifluous, romantic voice.
It
well.
Is
big
and
know.
Sexy yeah.
and very sexy.
Yeah.
Floating, falling, sweet intoxication. Touch me, trust me, savor each sensation. Let the dream begin. 'cause I'd give in to the power of the music that I write. The power of the music of the night.
And you, this was your first musical for the movies you've directed.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to do others? The Woman in White, perhaps? You're going to go through the Andrew Lloyd Webber catalog and do a few more?
You know, I always try to do something different mm-hmm. each time I make a movie, so this was such a wonderful experience. I'd have to be this passionate, mm-hmm. this inspired, because I think when you're doing, especially a famous musical, you really have the pressure of not failing the people who created the original. Mm-hmm. And I think the only thing you have to offer is passion, and if you don't have that, you should stay away from it. It mm-hmm. should never be a job or a chore. You know, it has to
be. And I think one of the things we talked about a lot is that some musicals, I think, probably don't translate that well into film as well.
Right.
You know,
oh,
you have to be quite
this was
careful.
Always, it's always been cinematic since the Lon Chaney. It's a sweeping romance, you know, and the great thing about, for me, because basically my job is just to be a storyteller, and if you take away the glamour, the mm-hmm. sets and the costumes and the horses and the chandelier, and if you take all that away, at the essence of it is this very tragic young love story.
Yeah.
And that's the reason to tell it. Her kissing him at the end is the reason to do the whole movie. The whole movie is leading up to that.
But the one thing you could never take away is the music, though, because the Phantom of the
Opera
is...
Well, no, and also I had the greatest score. I mean, I had one of the greatest scores in the world, and not every musical has that.
Yeah, that's true. And also, I think of the old-fashioned opera when I think of Phantom of the Opera, because your music for the Phantom does what... You know, Puccini's music does, it just deepens the characters in that relationship.
Yes, all the music here is actually our dialogue. It's actually our script because it moves the plot along and it gives you the inner monologues of the human being.
That was the biggest worry that all of the Hollywood lot had, the idea that you could have something which is through sung, more or less completely through sung, and that, in fact, you forgot that it was being sung, and that, you know, the art dialogue is as Joel says, it's musicalized.
This is why Andrew bought the rights back.
You know,
and did you know that he and his company raised all the money, and this was financed by Andrew and his company, so therefore, it was just us.
Well, this is what you did not want a Hollywood studio being able to dictate to you how to make this movie?
I mean, it was marvelous that
they
didn't
were so worried about the music.
They were worried, I mean, about the thought. I mean, early on, I mean, when
now they love it, of course.
But I mean, but also they've been fantastic about it. You know,
they've been wonderful, absolutely wonderful.
But at the same time, though, I mean, I do remember 4 years ago on one meeting with some executive who has gone now, I think, from Warner Brothers some while ago, saying to me, "Well, we understand why people would sing in an opera house, but we don't quite understand why Christine and Raoul would sing on the roof of an opera house because people don't sing there." And I said, "Well, you see, the thing is, I said, look,
this is what you have to put up with every day out there.
They do in West Side Story.
And I said,
they sing a lot on the roof."
I said, "You know, you could argue, and you're probably right, that in The Sound of Music, that it's okay to sing in the convent because they sing at church services there, but it is not right for a girl to be singing on a hill, with The Sound of Music.
Wouldn't it scare the goats?"
Well, I'm glad you guys prevailed in this argument against studio executives. It's a beautiful movie, beautifully sung, beautifully scored, beautifully shot. Joel Schumacher, the director, and Andrew Lloyd Webber, the composer of The Phantom of the Opera, just released in movie theaters near you, as they say, in your business.
Thank you so
thank
much
you
thank
for,
you for being
us.
Our guest.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks to the Friends of Theatre Talk, for their significant contribution to this production. Theater Talk is made possible in part by the Friedrich Loh Foundation, the Eleanor Naylor Dana Charitable Trust, the Alan S. Gordon Foundation, the Corey and Bob Dinelli Charitable Fund, Carrie J. Fries, the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, and the New York State Council on the Arts, a state agency.
Playbill Online is the official website of Theater Talk and the home of the Playbill Club, providing information and opportunities for theater lovers. Welcome your questions or comments for Theater Talk. Thank you and good night.